When did you guys start playing soccer?
Jules, can you think back that far? I cannot remember back that many years.
Okay,
it's been that long. I was 6, 7.
What are you looking forward to in the game tomorrow? Besides winning?
I'm looking forward to playing together again.
Yeah.
The last time
we'll all play together.
Are you sad that you're going away?
Well, when you put it that way, Corey.
And we always said, you know, we could really make a huge impact on the sport if people just had a glimpse at what we were all about, you know. We could get so many kids to try soccer, to start playing it, to really get interested in the game.
The women got their chance in 1996, when the biggest sporting event in the world came to the United States, and it included women's soccer for the first time.
You can win all the World Cups in the world. Until you win Olympic gold, you're not really validated. So to get the opportunity to play in the first ever Olympics in Atlanta, Georgia, and do it in the United States was just a dream come true.
But the dream was in jeopardy when the players fell into a contract dispute with their employer, the U.S. Soccer Federation. Though salaries were at $1,000 a month, the women wanted what the men's team was getting, bonuses for any medal won. The women were being offered a bonus only for the gold. Some unhappy players sought advice from a trusted friend.
I would get calls, and this is the kind of, Julie, it's so funny. Hey, King, help, on the phone, like, call me now.
I had been telling her, we have all these issues, and we're trying to get, the Federation to pay attention to it, and they're not paying attention to it. And she was like, hello, why are you asking the Federation to solve your problems? You guys have to solve your problems as a team.
You just don't play. That's the only leverage you have. You don't have a lot of money, you don't have a lot of other things, but you don't play because they depend on you. You're representing them, you make them money, and you have to say no. And I finally said, you've only got one thing left, and that's the Olympics.
That whole negotiation process was very scary. At 96, I'm 25 years old. We all have a chance to be in the first Olympics ever. And we're all talking about not going in and maybe not ever going to the Olympics.
So we didn't come in, the top team. And so they brought in a B and C team.
As any time there's labor unrest, there's big question marks. And I had the opportunity to bring in some players to training camps that might not have gotten a chance to otherwise. One of these players was Brandi Chastain.
I was a scrub or a scab, or I came back and played at a time when those players were on strike, literally. And thankfully, not one of them said, don't do it. And I felt this could be my only chance to get back with the national team. So the dispute with U.S. Soccer changed my career.
Having settled the issue, the players rejoined Brandi Chastain and the rest of the team. In resolving the dispute, U.S. Soccer reached a compromise with the players. The women would receive bonuses not only for a gold medal, but for a silver as well. Plus, a gold would bring each of the top players minimum $20,000 bonuses. The team was now ready to take advantage of the Olympic spotlight.
The United States of America!
The U.S. stayed unbeaten and reached the semifinal. They still felt the sting of losing the World Cup to Norway the year before and were out for revenge.
We put a picture of the Norwegian team, put it right by the door. And every day we left to go to training, that's what we saw. And some days we'd punch it. You'd walk by and be like, oh. Because they had what we wanted. They were the number one team and that's where we wanted to be.
The U.S. team drew crowds never before seen at women's soccer matches in America. Their semifinal game against Norway attracted almost 65,000 fans and turned into an overtime thriller. The first team to score would earn the right to play China for the gold medal.
Well, I'm dribbling towards their goal, and it just like the Red Sea parts. So I make this huge long run with the ball, which is a little bit unlike me. I see Mac on the left side cutting across. place went crazy.
It was sweet to watch the Norwegians walk off the field, you know, it was nice. I was like, okay, haha, to you guys, to the Norwegians, and now focus on the final. Now we've got to win a gold medal.
22 and a half minutes into the second half.
It was a back and forth game with China, and then we score in the last like 10 minutes, and they blow the whistle, and it was just, everyone went crazy.
It's over! The United States has won the first ever gold medal in women's soccer, 2-1 over China.
It was a moment you just didn't want it to end. You just wanted to stay on that field forever.
It was really the rebirth of our team where we became the best in the world again. And the vision I have of my players standing on that top podium, having those gold medals put around their neck, I'll never forget.
The fans in the stadium had witnessed the U.S. team's historic victory. The rest of the country wasn't nearly as fortunate.
Let's go back to Bob in this broadcast center as the Americans have won it.
All right, Jim, thanks a lot.
No one saw it live on television, and if they did see it, they saw snippets of it.
I think the best avenue to get to fans is through television, so it was a little disappointing in the fact that we didn't get more time.
Again, you know, you thought, we're such on the brink of really changing this sport, and it's like, you kind of shrug.
This question is for Mia.
But despite the live TV blackout, the word was out. What the nearly 78,000 fans had seen in person caught the attention of Madison Avenue. And suddenly, women's soccer had a recognizable face.
U.S. gold medalist Mia Hamm spends 90 minutes destroying her hair and 90 seconds bringing it back. Pert Plus, simply great hair, simply.
We would never give it to her. What are you talking about? He'd be like, hi, Mia!
That became the greeting.
Yeah. I mean, I have a good sense of humor, but I don't like to be embarrassed. And these guys seem to embarrass me every chance they get.
No.
But, I mean, they cut my hair and colored my hair. And,
get out of here.
Yeah. And they paid me.
I thought the shampoo did that.
Yeah. No, and they plucked my eyebrows. I mean, it was a day of beauty.
The 1996 Olympics is when Mia took off as the face of women's soccer. That's when the phenomenon took off.
Mia!
That's when all the screaming 12-year-olds first took notice of her.
She reached out beyond just the soccer fan. You know, she hit mainstream America.
Had enough?
Let's go.
You know, we always joke your shoulder's sore because you've been carrying us for so long. You know, how's your back?
The shot, goal! She's got the record!
I'm not the fittest. I'm not the fastest. I'm not the smartest player. I'm not the one that people are picking first every single time. You find those in these guys. I did not make this team. The team wasn't built on me. I am more dependent on them than they will ever be of me.
Mia's reluctance to be in the spotlight was nothing new. As a kid, she happily hid in the shadow of her big brother.
My parents adopted Garrett when I was 5, he was 8. And for me, he was an instant playmate. I wanted to be him. You know, whatever he did, I wanted to do just like him.
She looked up to him like nobody else. I think he's the reason that, you know, she started playing soccer.
You know, he was quarterback of the football team, played center field and baseball, was a great soccer player. So I remember countless hours that I would sit there and practice, you know, throwing a baseball or throwing a football. So his friends wouldn't make fun of me, so he wouldn't be embarrassed to have me around.
The brother that had been such an inspiration in Mia's rise as an athlete had to forego his own ambitions when he was diagnosed at age 16 with aplastic anemia, a rare blood disease he would battle for years.
He found the strength to come to Atlanta. One of the strongest memories of that Olympic Games was after we won. He was the first person that I hugged, and tears kind of coming down his face, and immediately I start crying, and he just was hugging me and saying how proud he was of me. For me to do what he couldn't do anymore, hopefully he was able to fulfill some of his dreams through me.
8 months later, Mia was at her brother's side.
I remember sitting at the foot of his bed and watched him take his final breath, you know? And it just stopped. Everything just stopped.
A week later, as Mia grieved with her family, her teammates offered support.
The team played a game and I watched it on TV. And the entire team comes out and begins the game, and they're all wearing black armbands. And I just lost it. That was motivation enough for me to get back there. And I remember playing in that first game and just all the emotion that was involved in it. And but I knew just being around them that I was gonna be okay, you know.
We just wanted her to score, because I think she wanted to score for her brother. It was just one of those things that I think at that moment released all the pain she had too, and was like, okay, I'm gonna play and remember for my brother.
I love these guys. They pulled me through some of my darkest days and have never once ever made me feel as if I was alone. Incredible teammates, but even more proud to call them my friends.
One last bus ride! Woohoo!
Julie, how do you feel? What? Tell me your emotions. Tell me what coursing through your veins.
I feel good. I feel so good.
I'll miss my fourth row seat where I sit every time I come.
Did you always sit in the fourth row?
Yeah.
See, I did not know that.
Really? Okay, you ready?
One more time off the bus, one more international match. Three great players will call a halt to their international careers tonight.
The 1999 World Cup was to take place in the United States. The games had been planned for small stadiums, but the organizers had a change of heart.
I was at the 1996 Olympics with a number of people from FIFA and U.S. Soccer, and it was a collective understanding that we had that this event had a lot more potential than we were previously giving it credit for. There was this core audience of people that were really excited about the sport, and we thought we could tap into that again for the 1999 Women's World Cup.
When it was announced, people were like, oh my goodness, you're gonna have the 99 World Cup in Giant Stadium, the Rose Bowl, you know, these Soldier Field, these huge football stadiums. What are you guys thinking?
To quiet the skeptics, the players worked overtime, promoting their cause.
There you go. You're welcome. How you doing?
The selling of women's soccer never ends. If this team was going to be big time, you know, you have to be there for your fans and the people that basically support it. Any time we could influence a child in a positive way, you know, we wanted to do that. We wanted to be there for those kids. No matter how long after the game, we had to stand there in the rain signing autographs.
Thank you very much. Thanks for your support.
It was another opportunity for us to impress upon a community, to say thank you to a community for their support, to really make a connection with those kids.
Did you have fun tonight?
Yes.
One of the problems with mainstream American sports today is that they've gotten so far from the people who watch them. This team came back to the audience.
How are you guys?
Good. How are you?
Good.
They were approachable, they were connective, and they looked like somebody who lived down the street from you.
Those players were everything. I mean, that's what people came out to see. We wanted to make sure that we were on as many soccer fields as possible and actually selling tickets right there on the sidelines and doing what we can to really spread the word through that kind of grassroots marketing.
4 months before the tournament, 210,000 tickets had been sold, far more than ticket sales for the entire 95 World Cup in Sweden. At a pre-tournament press conference, the news was too good to keep quiet.
Carl and I, as the captains, are sitting up there, and I mean, just hundreds of people and reporters, and the first person to stand up is a reporter from the United States. This is an embarrassment. You're lying about ticket sales. No one's gonna come.
You know, just hearing that negativity, you're thinking, well, God, you know, you kind of start to get anxious, and, you know, maybe you won't fill it up. Maybe you won't sell it out.
And I can remember sitting up there, and with complete confidence, we're like, what are you talking about? We're gonna be fine. You know, we're gonna sell the Rose Bowl. We're gonna sell out Giant Stadium. We're gonna do it all. And afterwards, we're like, we better freaking sell it out. We just made it sound like we were gonna.
This is it, baby.
But nobody, not even the players, knew how many of the 78,000 seats would actually sell for the opening game.
We're going to the game. And we start getting closer around the turnpike to the exit for the Meadowlands. And there's traffic. And I'm like, okay, there's always traffic. I mean, this is New York, New Jersey area.
What is the traffic jam going into Giant Stadium? Like, what are all these people doing?
All of a sudden, you know, Giant Stadium comes into focus.
And then we look and they have, you know, signs and painted cars and, you know, Go USA. And we're like, where are they going?
Oh my gosh, all these cars are for us. Get to the parking lot, and people are tailgating. It's like you're going to an NFL football game. And it was the coolest thing. And you can see the banners, Women's World Cup, and we're all like, it's here. Like, America, they understood. They got it. They knew who we were, and they were coming out to see us play by the thousands.
Can you imagine how we felt as an organizing committee on the day of the opening match at Giant Stadium, and we put more people in the stands than the Giants ever have. And the sound was different. It was the sound of young voices.
The cheering as we came out, I remember kind of having a little bit of a cry, like, this is unreal.
Here we go, Brad, here we go!
My biggest concern after I got on the field was my players, I'm watching, there's tears coming down their eyes. I'm saying, my God, are they so emotional? Are they going to be able to play?
Hamm brings it down, still on it with the left foot, and the goal!
As it turns out, this thing developed a life of its own.
We're talking about the summer. There's not much going on sports-wise, so it was a perfect timing. Everything came in alignment at just the right time to see this type of explosion.
The game last night had sold 74,200 tickets. It means in all likelihood it will be a sellout.
Yeah!
I have six tickets on the sale.
And the ticket became the hottest ticket in sport for that summer.
You had the perfect cast. They were the girls next door. There was a freshness to them. There was a wholesomeness to them. And it was just the right mix of that kind of sexuality with athleticism,
And you know what? They were good.
McMillan drives it across the head.
You go down to the newsstand and there's the New York Times front page, not the front page of the sports, front page, big picture, women's soccer. Washington Post, big picture, women's soccer, on the front page. Upside, inside out. Living
the vida loca. Carla's husband, do you know what's going on here? Like, this is a revolution. Like, you guys are making a difference. And we're like, really? We're just trying not to throw up before our, you know, our next game.
You heard it! Go! The USA goes out of the semi-final! The shot! Saints go!
We also knew that it all was contingent on us staying in the tournament. We had to keep winning.
That's it. The USA is going to the final of the World Cup.
It was too good to be true. More than 90,000 fans packed the Rose Bowl to watch the final between the U.S. and China. The game became the biggest women's sporting event in American history.
July 10th, 1999 probably was a defining moment in not just women's sports history, but sports history. For the first time, a group of female athletes had captured the attention of the world.
I would have never imagined this happening in my lifetime. 90,000 people sitting in a Rose Bowl to watch a women's soccer game.
When you have a rare event in mainstream sports that gets the men and the women and the kids, and it doesn't happen very often, it's seismic. I mean, this was the female equivalent of a Michael Jordan-type phenomenon.
I remember seeing these teenage kids, boys, who had Mia Hamm written across their chest. And I'm like, aha, we're on to something now.
You know, we did it. We made it. We're here. What an amazing accomplishment, not just about our team, but the entire event.
This is the biggest game in the lives of these USA players.
Now it was just about playing.
USA attacks, and it's space it comes. Here's Mia, tackle the way.
Having lost two of three matches to China earlier in the year, the U.S. was determined to stop their explosive offense.
So my job was to don't let Sun Wen score, who was their big goal scorer. And basically, if you shut her down, your team would win. And I was gonna smash everyone that was in my zone so they would not want to come near me. So that's how I played the whole game.
Michelle's game plan was working wonders against China, but it was facing a losing battle against her greatest nemesis, chronic fatigue.
I didn't think I would make it. 15 minutes into the game, I was like in a tunnel in my head. So it was constant like struggle in my mind to stay sharp and still, you know, stay on my feet for as long as possible.
Hurrying, strikes it hard, scoring comes up. We've got a player down for the United States. Looks like Michelle Akers is the player down.
I couldn't get my wits about me to get up, and I was almost blacking out. That was it. I couldn't get up. That was the last straw.
When we got her to the sideline, I said, how are you doing? Can you play? Because we have now a break. You know, it's like a minute to go, and then we go into overtime.
And Tony's going, can you go in? Can you go in? And I was like, yes, yes, I can go in. And I was like lilting over, you know. And my doc is going, ksh, you know, I saw him go like that. I'm like, what do you mean?
he was the coach at that point. You know, I was going to jeopardize her health, and they took her right away into the locker room.
You realize, God, I was that sick. I shouldn't have. Why was I even out there?
I thought when Michelle left the game that they were going to lose, to be honest. I just thought that she meant so much, and they needed her on the field.
The U.S. had to pull together in overtime, knowing that the next goal would decide the championship.
We worked this fucking hard to not finish this off. We finished this off. We beat them to every ball. They are dead tired. Remember that.
Keep the ball. Come on, ladies.
They're dead tired. Come on. It's right now.
Come on, lights.
1, 2, 3.
Who's this is up?
It was a boost for the Chinese because all of a sudden, they started to penetrate in that part of the field. That just shows you the respect they had for Michelle Akers. As soon as Michelle Akers is out, we can attack that space.
Silhouette with some space down the middle. She fires, it's deflected, and it went wide. Corner kick, number 4 for China. Those deflections get scary. Next goal wins it.
And the U.S. definitely is lacking some size and height without Akers in there on defense.
It's so hot. I'm pouring the water on my head. And I have my hand up on the net for my little security. And the ball comes and, you know, it just all happens so fast.
Off the corner from China. Header! Send up the line! Rebound was cleared! The ball was headed for goal!
I dive. I know it's by me. I'm in the air, and I remember thinking as I'm diving, oh shit, because I can't get it.
I saw the ball go by Brianna, and I literally dipped my head.
But then it comes back, and I'm like, oh shit.
All of a sudden, I heard a cheer, and the ball was out, and I didn't even know who did it. And all of a sudden, my mom was, it was your sister, it was your sister.
Lil, my gosh. I mean, we would have lost.
Jules and I were running out together and just looking at each other like, holy shit, did that just happen?
And I remember just yelling like, keep it up, you can keep doing it. And she gave me the look of like, would you please go sit back down in your seat? I know what I'm doing now. I'm not your little sister out here.
That's it. The 1999 Women's World Cup will be decided on penalty kicks.
Soccer is the worst because you go from this incredible back-and-forth game of athleticism and teamwork to kicking penalty kicks?
Before the PK session started, we had a very short moment to meet with our coach. We all believed that we already won because my goalkeeping skills are very good. My coach didn't give any technical plans. He just smiled and said, Gao Hong, this is your time. I also smiled and said, 10 more minutes, you will be the coach of the world champions.
What I told Bri before the penalty kicks, I said, Bri, you save one and you're a hero. You save two and they're going to build a monument in your hometown. The pressure is all on the striker.
On the referee's whistle, Hui Lin with a shot and a goal. China's up. The shot and the goal. One apiece. Here's her shot, and she scores. Goal. Gao Hong never moves.
My philosophy in that situation was, I'm just going to focus on myself and not even look at the kickers. So on the third kicker, as I'm walking into the goal, I actually looked at her this time. And her body language was horrible. She had almost a desire to not want to be doing this at all. And I could see it. It was the strangest thing. And I remember thinking, this is the one.
The shot! Save! Scurry!
I was just fired up. You know, I didn't know what to do with myself. And the thing was, I was like, oh, I got two more kickers.
All eyes now on Christine Lilly for the USA to take the lead. Lilly, the shot, go! 3-2 USA. Zhang will take this kick. This is a critical kick for her. She could tie it. Zhang, and she scores. What a calm shot that was. It's tied.
The last 2 weeks leading up to that event, I mean, I was taking penalty kick after penalty kick, and I could not hit a thing.
Mia Hamm with a chance to give her team the lead.
We get to the final game, and they put me in the top five, and I was looking at our coach going, have you not seen any of these kicks that I've taken?
Mia hates to take penalties. She's never wanted to take penalties. I said, Mia's got to take a penalty tomorrow because I'm not going to not have, if the game is on the line, we're not going to not have the greatest woman scorer in history on the sideline.
The greatest goal scorer in the world is ready. Set it goal! China must score here. And China sends their best player, Sun Wen. Sun Wen's shot, and she scores. Even up again, but it also means that the USA could win the World Cup on this next kick. Chastain will take it.
The player who had once been cut from the team now held its fate in her hands.
Building on the drama of the penalty kicks, we're seeing Brandi Chastain step up as the fifth kicker. And what we knew at the time was that Brandi had missed earlier on a penalty kick in the spring in a game against China. And the U.S. team had lost there. You know, Gao Hong would try to play some mind games. I mean, you hear the players would talk about her. She would do something to maybe try to distract the shooter.
I will go near the person and smile at her. I will take off my cap and show my forehead and look right into their eyes to find clues of their intention.
She stared me down. So as I was making my way to the penalty spot, the only thing going through my head was, don't look at the goalkeeper. Don't look at the goalkeeper. Don't look at the goalkeeper.
I realized they wouldn't look into my eyes, and I couldn't get any eye contact with them. I was really confused. I couldn't focus on my game. Nobody would look at me.
We were, you know, all holding hands and just saying a lot of prayers and going, come on, I'll go to church every Sunday.
I remember I was like, I couldn't even look. I was looking down at the ground. I was plugging my ears, just waiting. Like the anticipation was killing everyone.
Go!
Whoa. Unbelievable. Relief, satisfaction, joy, everything you can imagine rolled up into one instant.
To finish it off in that fashion, not just to win the World Cup, but to win in front of so many people and to have done it after people said we couldn't do it. You know, it's just this like, oh, thank God, you know, we've done it.
I was pulling my IVs out and they're like, no, you know, you have to stay here. I said, no, if you don't take them out, I'm pulling them out. So they took them out and I got a jersey on and then I came out on the field. I remember just thinking, oh, you know, okay, I can rest, you know, we're the best. And we did it. I was like the last original player from the first team who had seen all that and gone through all that, and then you're, you know, to this place that's so opposite of where you started.
But their moment of triumph was mixed with controversy.
You know, when I look at it, I think, how could one piece of material cause so much of a stir? In soccer, on the men's side, you see players, you know, that has been a usual celebration, but never once did I ever think that I would do that.
Well, I think the statement is like, I'm a strong woman, I'm proud, this is me.
people tried to spin it different ways, and it was like, no, it was just a moment of pure, raw celebration.
I looked at it like, we're free. We met every standard, we filled the stadium, we're successful, we're athletes, and we're free of this burden that we have to prove anything anymore. We won.
At the time, you weren't sitting around thinking about the historical context for women's sports. All you were thinking was that it was one of the greatest goddamn games you'd ever seen in your whole life at anything. Everybody forgot that they were chicks.
Nobody knew the impact that that game would have. You know, the idea that these were athletes as opposed to female athletes. There was an acceptance of the fact that the woman athlete was not here just to be on the sideline anymore. They wanted to be on the field.